McGraw-Hill Ascent Audio presents Solving for Project Risk Management, Understanding the Critical Role of Uncertainty in Project Management by Christian B. Smart, narrated by Barry Abrams. Publisher's note: in this audio edition, you will hear references to illustrations, figures, graphs, and tables present in the print and ebook formats of this book. Introduction. Before its launch, the Titanic was touted as being unsinkable. Its tragic maiden voyage in 1912 is a realization of risk, which is the possibility of a hazardous event. Risk has a variety of dimensions that can be broken into two distinct categories: technical and resource. Technical risks are those that threaten the performance of a system. Resource risks are those that present the possibility of cost increases or schedule delays. When technical risks are realized, they result in system impairment or even outright failure. The occurrence of resource risks leads to additional cost and/or longer schedules. There are some notable examples of technical risks. These include the space shuttle disasters in 1986 and 2003. The nuclear disasters of Chernobyl in 1986 and Fukushima in 2011, and the oil spills from the Exxon Valdez oil tanker in 1989 and the Deepwater Horizon drill in 2010. Not all technical failures are catastrophic. For example, the Hubble Space Telescope was put into space with a primary mirror that was polished to the wrong shape. It was a problem that took years for NASA to fix with servicing missions. A recent example of a disastrous system failure is the Boeing 737 MAX aircraft, which experienced fatal crashes in 2018 and 2019. This failure culminated in the indefinite grounding of the plane. While technical failures occur from time to time, resource issues are a far more common occurrence. Most projects do not experience significant technical issues, but the vast majority suffer from cost overruns and schedule delays. In some industries, such as aerospace and defense, more than 80% of projects experience cost overruns, and 90% experience schedule delays. Average cost growth for development projects exceeds 50%, and 1 in 6 more than doubles in cost. This imbalance of risk between technical and resources is due to a lack of attention to the issue of resource planning and management. This book has been written to address the issues of risk management of resources, the importance of addressing and planning for risks, the common problems encountered in resource risk management, and ways these can be fixed. Throughout, we will also address technical risk, especially its connection with resource risk. The two have a strong connection, as technical problems typically have significant resource impacts. While many of the issues and solutions we discuss also apply to technical risk, the focus of this book remains resource risk. The most well-known examples of big cost overruns and long schedule delays are for large projects. The absolute dollars and years spent on these complex systems can be enormous. When NASA began planning the successor to the Hubble Space Telescope, which is now called the James Webb Space Telescope, JWST, it convened a meeting of managers, scientists, engineers, cost estimators, and other program professionals to determine how to design a system with a price tag of $1 billion or less. In inflation-adjusted dollars, that amounts to approximately $1.5 billion. Despite the initial plans for JWST to cost less than Hubble, JWST is much more complex. It has a bigger mirror that is in a folded-up configuration when launched and then unfolds in space. JWST will be outside of a low Earth orbit after it is launched. Current launch capabilities for astronauts are only to low Earth orbit, so there is no option to repair it once it is launched. The planning for JWST started in 1996 with an expected launch in 2007. There was a significant amount of cost and schedule growth from program initiation. This resulted in a program replan in 2005. In 2010, JWST was called the telescope that ate astronomy because it was consuming a large amount of the space science budget. As a result, other astronomy objectives could not be achieved due to lack of available funding. As of March 2020, the planned launch date was in 2021, a 14-year delay, and the expected program costs exceed $9.7 billion, a more than six-fold increase from the initial plan. Programs with this amount of cost growth often get canceled. However, sometimes even problem programs, when they are high priority, continue onward. Even though resource risks are most prominent in large projects, significant cost and schedule growth often occur in more mundane endeavors. For example, in 2004, the city of Huntsville, Alabama signed a contract for construction of an 1,100-bed addition to the local jail for $25 million. The initial schedule was to complete this effort in 3 years. However, the city called a halt to construction after an inspection discovered cracks in the support beams. Due to these findings, it terminated the contract with the builder. The city then hired another company to finish the project. These actions led to significant delays and cost increases. The addition was eventually finished in May 2010, 3 years behind schedule. Also, the city and the original builder sued each other. This resulted in the city of Huntsville spending another $3 million in legal expenses and paying the original contractor an additional $2 million. The total cost of the project exceeded $80 million, more than triple the initial contract. Even though it might appear that such a project should be simple, jails require sophisticated components such as electronic locks and security systems with which average building contractors may not have experience. The city of Huntsville did not vet the contractor before awarding the contract, but merely went with the lowest bid from an out-of-town company that had never worked with the city. As this example reveals, cost overruns and schedule delays can occur in what may appear to be simple building and infrastructure projects. Understanding risk is challenging. The second law of thermodynamics states that entropy, which is the level of disorder in the universe, is always increasing unless there is some intervening action that occurs to stop it. My son once tossed a plate from our dinner table. When it hit the floor, the plate shattered. The plate was in one piece on the table only moments before and was nice and orderly. An intervening action would have been to catch the plate as it fell off the table. There was nothing to be done to make the plate more orderly, but there are plenty of opportunities, especially in the hands of a small boy, to quickly make things messier. Entropy is a complicated process. The famous physicist and mathematician John von Neumann once stated that no one really understands entropy. Similarly, risk is a difficult concept to grasp. It too always seems to be increasing everywhere. Like a dinner plate on a table, there is little that can change, if anything, to make it better, but many things can go wrong. There are many more ways for costs and schedules to increase than to decrease. This includes all kinds of projects: aerospace, defense, infrastructure, construction, and many others. Some projects are inherently riskier than others, but all projects bear some resource and technical risk. A former NASA colleague of mine once wrote, "Without some intervening action, chaos will eventually rule project management." To guard against risk, much more intervening action is needed, especially in the measurement and management of risks. This does not mean that we should not take risk. Risk-taking is as American as apple pie. Walter Wriston, the CEO of Citibank/Citicorp from 1967 to 1984, noted that in the 1980s that society had become averse to risk to the point it had become another four-letter word. He argued for risk-taking by stating, "The driving force of our society is the conviction that risk-taking and individual responsibility are the ways to advance our mutual fortunes." However, That does not mean we should take risks blindly. We need to understand the risks we face and use that information to make rational decisions. Not doing so has led private companies to take too few risks and government organizations to take too many. Private companies, faced with bankruptcy if they take on too much risk, often err on the side of risk avoidance in the absence of proper risk management. By contrast, government organizations, which lack incentives to avoid hazards, often take on too much risk. The term black swan is often used to refer to unpredictable events that have extreme consequences. Risk management often ignores them. Due to their significant consequences, plans should be made to deal with black swan events. The phenomena that lead to such events have the property that no matter how severe the consequences of such events in the past, it is only a matter of time before an even worse one occurs in the future. Reducing their impact requires careful consideration, fast action, and even overreaction. For example, during the COVID-19 pandemic, Taiwan swiftly acted early in the outbreak in January 2020 to shut its borders and require people to wear face masks. As a result, by May 2020, the island nation had only 440 confirmed cases of infection and 6 deaths. Normalizing for population, Taiwan had only 18 cases per million people, tiny compared to the global average of 513. Which translates to only 0.3 deaths per million people compared to 35.3 globally. Current risk management practice is a fantasy conceived of optimism and willful ignorance. I have firsthand experience with this in my profession. I have worked as a consultant with NASA and the Department of Defense and have served as a government employee at a Department of Defense agency. During my time as a civil servant, I worked closely with project managers and senior leaders, including several generals and admirals. I have had an inside view of how decisions are made. Project managers do some things extremely well. They ensure the development, production, and operations of complex systems, and those systems work as designed most of the time. Many projects involve solving hard engineering problems. You know the saying, it doesn't take a rocket scientist. Well, sometimes it does. Government weapons systems and aerospace programs are examples where many rocket scientists are needed. Many other organizations in a variety of fields, such as infrastructure, mining, and chemical processes, also require sophisticated engineering. All these organizations have detailed, sound approaches to the technical planning process. However, most of the time, these same projects lack solid resource planning. Instead, resource risks are routinely ignored and lack proper consideration. Planning for the resources required by a portfolio of systems is poorly done and extremely short-sighted. Alas, to many project managers, risk is often just another four-letter word. This book is written with the intention to provide information that can help fill the risk management void that exists in project management practices. The common occurrence of large cost overruns and long schedule delays provides overwhelming evidence of significant cost and schedule risk in most projects. It also demonstrates that in general, this risk is not being managed well. The case for quantitative analysis of risk for projects is made. There are several problems with the current state of practice because even when risk is quantitatively assessed, it is not done well. Several of these issues are addressed, and ways to fix them are provided. Risk does not need to be just another four-letter word. It is an important part of project management. When managed correctly, it can be used to make smarter decisions and help ensure project success. Chapter 1. Show me the data. The enduring problems of cost growth and schedule delays. Gottfried von Leibniz was a German polymath who lived in the 17th and early 18th centuries. Two of his most well-known contributions include co-inventing differential and integral calculus and his philosophy of optimism. Leibniz believed that we live in the best of all possible worlds. This was lampooned by the French writer, historian, and philosopher Voltaire, who caricatured him as Professor Pangloss in his novel Candide. Throughout the novel, Pangloss suffers from a series of misfortunes. Among other calamities, he is enslaved on a Turkish ship and almost executed by the Inquisition. Despite this, Pangloss remains optimistic. This gave rise to the term Panglossian, which means extreme optimism, especially when faced with misfortune. One of the chief sources of cost and schedule risk, as we shall discuss in this chapter, is a Panglossian outlook on the part of project managers. Just like the professor with an always sunny outlook even when storm clouds threaten, project management as a profession has refused to face the reality that we live in a hazardous world. The evidence for this is the abundance of cost growth and schedule delays for a wide variety of projects. Cost and schedule growth reflect changes in dollars and time from one point to a later point. A program budgets for $100 million, but the final actual cost doubles to $200 million by completion. A program plans for a 3-year schedule, but it takes 9 years instead. Growth is calculated based on the increase in cost or amount of time divided by the earlier cost or amount of time, respectively. To express a number in percentage terms, it is multiplied by 100. For example, in the case of the increase from 3 years to 9 years, the increase is 6 divided by 3 equals 2, or 200%. Cost growth and schedule delays are systemic and enduring issues. Many projects in a wide variety of industries regularly experience them. Depending on the application, average cost growth ranges from 30 to 50%, and it is much higher in many cases. For most endeavors, at least 1 in every 6 projects more than doubles in cost from initial projections during the development phase. In accordance with the adage that time is money, schedule delays are also significant. Depending on the type of project, in percentage terms, schedule delays can average just as much and sometimes more than cost increases. These two interrelated problems have been consistently high for decades with little change over time. When you see the word average, you probably think about a likely or expected outcome. An average represents the central tendency of a data set. In statistics, 3 different kinds of averages are commonly used: the mean, median, and mode. These values have a significant impact on our treatment of risk, so they are the most meaningful measures for our purposes. For a discrete set of points, the mean is the sum of data points divided by the size of the data set. Just like the center line on a road, the median is the 50-50 point. Half the outcomes are greater than the median and half are less. That is, there is a 50% chance of a result less than the median and a 50% chance of a result greater than the median. The mode is the most likely occurrence. When data points are evenly spread in a symmetric pattern around the average, these 3 measures are all the same. For example, given the 5 data points 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, the mean, median, and mode are all 3. This is because the data points are symmetric about 3. Given the 7 data points 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, 10, 20, the mean is, open parentheses, 1 plus 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 5 plus 10 plus 20, close parentheses, divided by 7 equals 6. The median is 3, since there are 3 data points, 1, 1, 2, that are less than 3, and there are 3 data points, 5, 10, 20, greater than 3. The mode is 1, since there are two occurrences of one in the set, while all the other numbers occur only once. When we refer to the word average in this chapter, we will be referring to the mean, because it considers the large cost and schedule risks. The second set of data points, 1, 1, 2, 3, 4, 10, 20, is skewed. That is, the largest numbers are farther away from the average than the smallest numbers. We see this often in practice in projects. The cost of a project can never be less than zero. It cannot be cheaper than free. Schedules cannot be negative, as time travel is impossible. However, both cost and schedule can increase significantly, as there is no true upper bound. Also, while it is possible that in some cases a project will discover an opportunity for savings, there is a built-in asymmetry. More things can go wrong than go right. As a result, cost is more likely to grow than shrink. Even if a program manager finds savings, he or she will likely not turn in the savings, but rather find ways to spend the money on the project. It is typically the case that once money is allocated, it will be spent. This is often referred to as the money allocated is money spent, MAMES principle. Note that the problems of growth and delay are distinct from the issues that some projects cost too much and take too long to develop. For example, the government is infamous for overpaying for simple items, such as $10,000 for a toilet seat cover. The subject of this chapter is increases in cost and schedule from one point in time to another. For development projects, the beginning point is typically the beginning of detailed design. Some organizations, such as NASA, start tracking cost and schedule before that point. The earlier the point in time a project starts tracking growth and delays, the greater the uncertainty and the greater the likelihood of growth and delays. But a fair starting point for a baseline is when preliminary designs are in place so that a project has a good sense of scope. Figure 1.1 displays a general timeline that applies to all projects. Figure 1.1, Timeline of Project Phases. Initial planning, to development, to production, to operations, to disposal. Some organizations have their own names for these phases, but the phases in Figure 1.1 apply to all projects. Initial planning is the start. Depending on complexity, this could be a short period or a long period affected by factors such as the use of advanced technologies, as some of the time for initial planning could be used for necessary technology development. Once initial planning is complete, the development process begins. This involves engineering work along with building prototypes and conducting tests. At some point during development, production begins. Production does not apply equally to all endeavors, and to some it does not apply at all. Weapon systems typically produce in quantities numbered in the hundreds and thousands. NASA satellites typically involve the production of one unit, as do infrastructure projects such as a bridge, tunnel, road, or dam. Software projects do not produce a tangible product at all. Endeavors that do not result in a physical product, or those that produce one unit, may consider any production to be part of the development phase. Once a product has been developed and produced, it needs to be operated and maintained. This can occur over a long period, such as years or even decades. This is typically the longest phase and often consumes the largest amount of cost and time in the life cycle of project. At the end of their useful life, a tangible, non-software product will need to be disposed of or destroyed. When measured from the beginning of development, the phase with the greatest amount of cost uncertainty is often development, so many studies of cost growth focus on this phase. However, it is not always the case that development has the greatest amount of risk for cost increase. If the product is a new configuration that is not like anything in the past, the operation and production phases can be risky as well. For example, The space shuttle was a radical departure from previous launch vehicles, such as the Saturn V that preceded it. The initial plans called for the shuttle to operate much like a conventional airplane, with one flight per week. However, this was wildly optimistic, as it never flew more than 9 times in 1 year. This low flight rate, combined with the complexity of the system itself, caused operations costs per flight to be much higher than initial projections. Production cost increases can be driven by errors in forecasting production quantities. When multiple units are to be produced and it takes years to develop a design, it is hard to accurately forecast quantities to be produced. The number of units produced is an important driver for production costs, as it is inversely correlated with the average unit cost. In most cases, there is a large fixed cost associated with manufacturing. When more units are produced, this cost can be spread over more units, which results in lower average unit cost. When fewer units are produced, this fixed cost is allocated across fewer units, thus raising the average unit cost. It always costs more and takes longer than you think. Cost increases and schedule stretches are commonplace for many different types of projects. Mega projects, those that cost billions of dollars, are often the focus of growth studies. However, most projects, regardless of size, experience cost and schedule increases. A recent NASA study showed average cost growth for 133 development programs was equal to more than 50% across a wide range of small to large projects, from those that cost tens of millions of dollars to those that cost billions. The equation in Figure 1.2 is simple. Take the planned cost and multiply it by 1.55 to get the best estimate of actual cost. This simple line explains more than 95% of the relationship between the planned and actual costs. Note that the scale of the graph in Figure 1.2 is on a log scale, which means that orders of magnitude 1, 10, 100, etc. are equally spaced. This is necessary to properly visualize data that varies over a wide range. This simple analysis is not intended as a band-aid to fix cost growth, as there is a significant amount of variation around the line that is diminished by the log scale. It is intended as an illustration that both small and large projects experience significant cost growth. The variations like those in Figure 1.2 have consistently been at this level for not only NASA, but also Department of Defense missions since the 1960s. I have also analyzed schedule growth for these types of missions, and the average schedule delay ranges from 27% to more than 50%. Norman Augustine, former Army official and former CEO of Lockheed Martin, one of the largest defense contractors in the United States, noted that the cost for development programs grows on average by 52%, which he called the Las Vegas factor of development program planning, as this is the amount estimates would need to increase in order to ensure that the project, akin to a casino in this analogy, will break even. Cost overruns get much attention, but schedule delays are important as well because time is a valuable resource. Augustine also noted that in his experience, schedules for development projects grew by 33% on average, which he termed the universal fantasy factor. Douglas Hofstadter, a cognitive scientist, noted that there were predictions in the early days of computer chess that it would only be 10 years before computers could play chess as well as the world champion. Claude Shannon, a mathematician who developed information theory, was an early pioneer in the field. He published a paper on programming a computer to play chess in 1950. Hofstadter noted that 10 years after that, there was an update to the prediction, which was that in another 10 years, computers would surpass the best human chess players. The point in time at which computers became superior to the best humans in chess always seemed to be 10 years away. This example led Hofstadter to coin the eponymous Hofstadter's Law. It always takes longer than you expect, even when you take into account Hofstadter's Law. However, There are often exceptions to such laws. Gary Kasparov, world chess champion from 1985 to 2000, predicted in 1990 that it would be at least 10 years before a computer could beat the best human chess player in a match. Kasparov would make a good project manager, as he was optimistic. His forecast was off by 3 years. In 1997, the IBM computer program Deep Blue defeated Kasparov in a 6-game chess match. To understand why Hofstadter's law holds, with the occasional exception for overconfident chess grandmasters, consider a thought experiment that most everyone can relate to: the daily commute to work. At one time, my daily commute by car to work ranged anywhere from 25 minutes to more than an hour. The typical or most likely commute time was around 35 minutes. Two factors that drove this time were when I left my house and the amount of school traffic. If I left my house early enough, I would avoid school traffic and many other commuters, and I could make it to work in 25 minutes. Also, during the summer and school holidays like Christmas and spring break, my commute was also about 25 minutes regardless of when I left home. However, there were other events that would slow me down. For example, road construction along my route to work happened occasionally and would slow my commute. I also crossed a train track going to work and sometimes would have to wait on the train. A significant part of my route was along an interstate, and occasionally there were wrecks that slowed my commute. My longest commute was over an hour. A car had crossed the median at a high speed, hitting another car head-on, and caused 2 deaths. My commute was typically 35 minutes. Only so many things could speed up my commute, but there were many events that could slow me down. The things that could go right were lack of school traffic and leaving for work earlier or later than usual. The things that could and did sometimes go wrong included waiting for a train crossing, a stalled car along the route, a car wreck along the route, someone stopped by a police officer for speeding, me being stopped by a police officer for speeding, road construction along the route, and school traffic, including bus traffic, being heavier than usual for some reason. It is much harder to overestimate the amount of time it takes to get to work than it is to underestimate, because there are so many more things that can happen to increase the time than to decrease it. As a result, schedule growth, like cost growth, is highly skewed to the right, or upside. Not only do development endeavors take longer than planned on average, they are rarely completed on time. I have discovered in my experience that schedule underruns are rare, and schedule slips are even more likely to occur than cost growth. C. Northcote Parkinson was a 20th century British naval historian and author of 60 books. Today, he is best remembered for Parkinson's Law, which states that work expands to fill the time available. Rather than finish early, projects typically use any spare time to continue system development, such as doing additional testing to ensure that the system works correctly. Show me the data! A few years ago, I compiled a data set of development cost growth for 289 NASA and Department of Defense programs and projects. The minimum cost growth was negative 25.2% for a super lightweight version of the shuttle external tank. The negative number means that the cost underran the initial budget by approximately 1/4 of the initial budget. 1 in 6 missions reported actual costs that were lower than the initial plan. The maximum cost growth among the missions studied was 474.8% for the Comanche helicopter program, which was eventually canceled before development was completed. The average cost growth for all missions was 52.0%. This value is the same as Augustine's Las Vegas factor that we discussed earlier. Most missions experienced relatively small amounts of cost growth. Half experienced growth less than 30%, with some missions experiencing extreme amounts of cost growth. 1 in 6 missions had cost growth equal to or in excess of 100%, which means cost at least doubled. Several years ago, I collected data on development schedule delays for 98 NASA missions. There was only one schedule underrun. This was for a well-managed in-house effort. It was an Earth-orbiting spacecraft that observed the time variation of a variety of X-ray sources, including black holes. 8 other missions were completed on time, which means more than 90% of the schedules had some amount of delay. The average delay was 38%. 10% of missions doubled or more in length of time. The longest delay was for the Ulysses program, a joint NASA and European Space Agency mission to study the Sun. Schedule delays are common in defense projects as well. A study of tactical aircraft, tactical is used to denote shorter-range weapons such as jet fighters, found an average 7% delay in length of development and 25% in production. A study of tactical missiles found an average 52% increase in development schedules and a 53% increase in production schedules. Another study of a variety of weapons systems found an average development schedule delay equal to 27.5%, with 9 of 10 missions experiencing increases in schedules. Cost overruns and schedule delays are not limited to aerospace and weapons systems development projects. Bent Flubia, a professor at Oxford, has been studying the issue of cost growth for large infrastructure projects for many years. He calls these large endeavors mega projects. He has studied a variety of different types: rails, bridges, roads, and tunnels, including the tunnel under the English Channel that connects England and France. In a large study of 258 transportation infrastructure projects, approximately 90% experienced cost growth. The average cost growth, depending on type, ranged from 20 to 45%. The average increase in schedule ranged from 23 to 45%. Flubia found that this pattern of growth has been remarkably stable over a 70-year period. Among the more spectacular examples of cost underestimation are the Sydney Opera House, with actual costs approximately 14 times higher than those projected, and the Concorde supersonic airplane, with cost 12 times higher than predicted. When the Suez Canal was completed in 1869, actual construction costs were 20 times higher than the earliest estimated costs and 3 times higher than the cost estimate in the year before construction began. Software and information technology projects are notorious for extreme cost and schedule growth. The average change in software requirements during development has been reported to average 1% to 2% each month and can be much higher. This means that the longer the project, the more requirements will change. For a 5-year project, on average, requirements will increase between 80 and 220%. For a 10-year project, this range is 230 to 980%. A commonly used metric for measuring the scope of a software project is called Equivalent Software Lines of Code, ESLOC. The number of lines of code is a count of the lines in the text that make up the instructions in a computer program. ESLOC represents new software lines of code to be developed, plus some fraction for integrating those previously developed. This metric is closely correlated with the cost of a software project. For military applications, a study of 131 data points found 51% average growth in ESLOC during development, and that 16% more than doubled. Another, smaller study for military missions showed similar programs averaged 49% ESLOC growth, with approximately 20% at least doubling in cost. A large survey of thousands of software and information technology development projects has tracked cost growth and delays from 2000 to 2008, finding that average cost growth ranged from 43 to 56%, average schedule delays ranged from 63 to 84%, and 24% of these kinds of projects failed. New oil field projects experience significant cost growth as well, with 30% experiencing overruns in excess of 50%. Hydroelectric power generation from dams often experiences significant cost growth and schedule delays. Dams require complex engineering and geological studies, as the amount of water contained can impact fault lines and cause seismic activity. Cost growth for these systems ranges on average from 24% to 96%, and schedule delays average 27% to 44%. The Olympics may have the worst record of all for cost growth of any project type. From 1968 to 2016, the average cost overrun was 156%. Almost half reported cost overruns in excess of 100%. The largest overrun was for the Montreal Olympics in summer 1976. The final cost was more than 8 times the initial plan. The date for an Olympics is set well in advance. Unlike most other projects, there have been no schedule delays in the past. This could be a factor in why the cost overruns are much higher than for other types of endeavors. However, the 2020 Summer Olympics planned for Tokyo was postponed in March of that year due to the COVID-19 pandemic. A schedule delay for an Olympics is unprecedented and a risk no one could foresee. Just as it always costs more and takes longer than you think, it is always riskier than you think. Table 1.1 summarizes cost and schedule growth across several industries. The averages for cost and schedule growth among industries varies from 20% for roads to 156% for the Olympics. Average schedule delays range from 0% for Olympics prior to 2020 to 84% for information technology and software projects. All projects experience regular, recurring cost and schedule growth. Cost overruns occur in 80% or more of projects, and schedule delays occur in 70% or more of projects, regardless of industry, as shown in the table by frequency of occurrence. The frequency of doubling is an important statistic. This indicates how often projects have more than doubled in cost from the initial plan. For every industry except roads, this is a relatively common occurrence, ranging from 1 in every 2 projects to 1 in every 12. These wide ranges make it difficult to grasp the true magnitude of risk and make basic statistics not useful for its analysis. I gave a presentation on risk at a workshop. When I discussed that the average cost growth for military and aerospace projects has historically been in excess of 50%, someone in the audience said that if you look at how many projects experience that much growth, it is much lower. That is true. As we mentioned earlier, due to skewness, 50% of military and space projects experience cost growth less than 30%. He considered this latter figure as evidence that most of the time projects get it right. I do not consider 30% cost growth to be getting it right, especially for billion-dollar programs, but that is not the point. Risk has 2 dimensions, likelihood of occurrence and consequence. Consequence is the more important of the two, but less appreciated, due to our innate need to be right. What causes trouble is the programs that more than double in cost. While they are not the majority, their growth is large enough to make a difference. We can be right 90% of the time, or even more frequently, but get wiped out by a blowout program that doubles, triples, or quadruples in cost. We will expound on this idea in later chapters. It's even worse than it appears. Ideally, growth in cost and schedule should be measured holding everything else constant, or what economists call other things being equal. However, that is impossible to do as performance is not fixed. When project managers find that their costs are growing and it is taking longer to accomplish work than planned, they may not always have the luxury of getting more money or more time. In such cases, the project either must stop work, which could mean cancellation, or it must cut scope to live within its means. In a canceled project, most, if not all, the work done is wasted. In some cases, technology development or part of a project can be transferred to another. Regardless, much time and effort are wasted when projects are canceled. For example, Hundreds of millions of dollars were spent on developing the canceled Ares 1 launch vehicle, part of NASA's Constellation program to replace the space shuttle. Cutting scope happens frequently and is one way that projects often cope with cost and schedule growth. A program may have originally planned to fly 5 scientific instruments on a satellite, but when faced with pressure to keep costs reined in, may instead fly only 3. Thus, the true risk is underaccounted for in the actual cost and schedule growth data, as the scope is not held constant. Without this option, programs would experience even greater cost overruns and even longer schedule delays. A satellite can remove a scientific instrument and still conduct at least part of its mission. Software can cut out features and still be worthwhile. A road project may plan to widen 2 lanes to 6, but due to overruns may only be able to expand to 4. In my experience with NASA and military projects, I have firsthand anecdotal evidence that development projects frequently cut scope to try to deal with overruns in money and time. The impact of this is that the risk management problem is even worse than is indicated by the numerous studies on cost and schedule growth. That is because the value of the delivered project is less than planned. Projects often end up paying more but getting less. This problem is not limited to aerospace and weapons systems. Large infrastructure projects that cost billions of dollars, typically referred to as mega projects, are criticized for frequent poor performance. The Ulysses space mission is a prime example of such a project. It was named after the Latin for Odysseus, the hero of Homer's Odyssey. The Ulysses spacecraft took a long voyage to study the sun. This was a joint project between NASA and the European Space Agency, ESA. The initial plan was to use 2 spacecrafts. One spacecraft was to be developed by each of the 2 agencies. Development started in October 1978, with a planned launch of both spacecraft on the space shuttle in February 1983. This was only 52 months. While 4 years and 4 months seems like a long time, the average development schedule for a NASA mission is 60 months. This average includes both Earth-orbiting and planetary spacecraft. Simple Earth-orbiting spacecraft can be developed, built, and launched in a few years, but deep space missions typically take much longer, a decade or more. Cassini, a mission to Saturn, took 110 months to develop, build, and launch, and Galileo, a mission to Jupiter, required 135 months. This latter mission, like Ulysses, was originally planned to be much shorter in terms of development time, only 43 months. Galileo's schedule tripled in length during development. The original plan for Ulysses was for NASA and ESA to each pay for the development of their respective spacecraft. NASA was to pay for the launch aboard the shuttle. To save money in fiscal year 1982, NASA delayed the planned launch. Congress cut the budget for the program. This caused NASA to cancel the development of its spacecraft. The result was a loss of half the instruments planned for the mission. However, NASA paid for the launch and for a radioisotopic thermal generator, a type of power source that uses a radioactive material often used on long-duration planetary missions. The launch was again delayed by the Space Shuttle Challenger incident. The overall costs, excluding the mission operations costs, decreased slightly from the initial plan, but this is hardly a good deal as the mission lost half its scope as a result. Another case of a potentially successful project that has significantly cut scope is the California High-Speed Rail, CHSR. The initial goal of this state government-funded project was to provide bullet train transportation with 520 miles of track from San Francisco to Los Angeles, with several stops. In 2008, planning began. Initial projections for cost were $40 billion, with completion planned for 2028. A one-way fare for one ticket from Los Angeles to San Francisco was expected to be priced at $55. 1 year later, the project was expected to cost $98.5 billion with a completion date in 2033, and a one-way ticket from the City of Angels to the City by the Bay was expected to cost $95. The section of the project where construction began, a 119-mile path in California's Central Valley between Madera and Bakersfield, was initially expected to cost $6 billion. Estimates for that rose to $7.8 billion in 2016. It increased again in 2018 to $10.8 billion. Of this latter $3 billion increase, $600 million was for reserves, so at least some attention was paid to risk. Estimates for the total project continued to fluctuate over the period from 2009 to 2019. The latest estimate published in early 2019 was $77 billion, almost double the initial forecast. On February 12, 2019, the Governor of California, Gavin Newsom, announced a significant scope reduction in his State of the State address. Governor Newsom said the new scope of the project was restricted to a 171-mile stretch from Merced to Bakersfield. This included the initial 119-mile track from Bakersfield to Madera, plus a 52-mile track from Madera to Merced. This smaller scope endeavor is projected to cost $12.4 billion. Plans also include the use of low-speed Amtrak trains rather than bullet trains. California Highway 99 travels directly between Merced and Bakersfield. The distance is 165 miles, and the drive time is projected as 2 hours and 26 minutes. A high-speed train could make the trip in about an hour, saving about 1.5 hours compared to a car trip. A $12.4 billion investment is a lot of money to provide fast trips between Bakersfield, population 380,000, to Merced, population 80,000. Unless this is eventually followed by completion of the original scope, this mega project will be a mega waste of time and money. This is a good example of the sunk cost fallacy. The California government has already spent a large sum of money, but it is never rational to continue with a project simply because a lot of money and time have already been devoted to it. Despite the irrationality of making decisions based on sunk cost, behavioral economists have noted its frequent occurrence. The pharmaceutical wholesaler Fox Myers' attempt in the mid-1990s to implement a new enterprise resource planning system is an example of a project that suffered cost overruns and schedule delays. It not only failed to perform up to expectations, it drove the company to bankruptcy. At the time it started the project, Fox Myers was an established large enterprise with annual sales in excess of $5 billion. Fox Myers' mainframe system needed replacement. The company decided to replace this with a then newly emerging business software product called Enterprise Resource Planning, ERP. This type of product unifies all processes with a company into one system. It replaces separate products for different departments, such as logistics, sales, and production, with one single software product. The company was also expected to receive additional business from a major new client, so it needed to be able to handle this additional workload. The company expected to save $40 million in annual operating costs once the new system was in place. The project began in 1993. The company invested $65 million and planned to complete implementation in 18 months. While initial testing of the system indicated that it could handle the increased workflow, it turned out it could only process 10,000 orders a day compared to the legacy mainframe system's capacity of 420,000. Despite the new product's limitations, Fox Myers' leadership refused to abandon the new product and continued to try to make the new system work. The cost rose to $100 million and the schedule slipped. In 1996, the company filed for bankruptcy. This information technology endeavor not only suffered from cost growth and schedule delays, but the technical performance was so abysmal that management's refusal to abandon it took down the company. Summary. We have shown that cost and schedule growth are consistently high across a wide range of projects. This has been the case for a long time and shows no signs of slowing. Not only is the track record bad, it is even worse than the historical data indicates. That is because in many cases, technical performance is reduced in order to mitigate cost and schedule problems. Projects spend more, take longer, and achieve less than planned. The next chapter discusses the key reasons for cost and schedule growth. Chapter 2. Here we grow again. Why cost increases and schedule delays occur. I am from the southeastern United States. My entire family is from that part of the country, dating back several generations. This region is known for colorful stories and expressions, and my family was no exception. My parents and grandparents related everything to stories. In school, especially early in college, I discovered that I needed to learn to move beyond thinking in stories and instead make deductions based on logic and facts. I later learned, in trying to communicate my work to other people, that I could draw on my family's storytelling background. I found that I could get my point across better as a narrative rather than as a dry set of facts and figures. In the last chapter, you got the college version of cost growth and schedules. We talked about the statistics of these phenomena: who, what, when, and where. In this chapter, we will talk about the why, and in relating stories about cost and schedule growth, provide a deeper understanding of these phenomena. Cost and schedule growth occur due to numerous reasons. These can be delineated into internal and external factors. Internal factors are those the project controls, and the external ones come from outside the project. Some can be included in both, but I will place them in the more appropriate category. Internal factors include optimism, planning, execution, errors in estimation, schedule, cost, and technical misalignment. External factors include constant change, external dependencies, black swans. This is not an exhaustive list, but it covers many of the issues that occur. One reason resource risk is more severe than technical risk is that all these factors impact resources, but not all influence system performance or technical requirements. A planning risk is that an emerging technology that is going to be used will not be mature when needed. This impacts technical performance, cost, and schedule. However, some sources of growth, such as reduction.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.